You do this because you really care about serving, and each one of the folks that put their name forward deserve our gratitude and appreciation for putting themselves forward for public service. So thanks so much. God bless you all. Take care.
We will be adhering to firm rules this evening concerning the length of the opening statements the candidates make, as well as the amount of time they have for responses and their closing. Our timekeepers this evening are club member Sherry Broadway and her husband Jerry. Leading us this evening are two moderators, Lynn McIntyre and Hal Coleman, and they are on my left. Lynn is a Roswell resident and businesswoman, member of the Atlanta League of Women Voters, and actively engaged in a variety of local issues ranging from education to the environment. Hal's family moved to Roswell in 1837, before it was Roswell. So he's about as native as you can get. He is a local businessman, a Roswell Rotarian, retired Roswell firefighter, husband, father, and grandfather. They will introduce the candidates, pose questions received through our website and from those of you who are here this evening.
Good evening, candidates, and welcome, audience, and elected officials, and those that are running for office. The rules tonight are starting with introductions by our candidates for judge, and we're going to give each of you 2 minutes to make your introduction, and after all the questions are asked, you'll have 1 minute for a wrap-up. So the order that we're starting in tonight, we'll start with John Monroe, then Brian Hansford, Melanie Elwanger, and then Leslie Donahue. Donahue, did I say that correctly?
It's Donahue.
Thank you. All right, John, you have your 2 minutes.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for coming tonight, and thank you to the Arousal Women's Club for sponsoring this forum. My name name's John Monroe. I grew up in Wisconsin, and I have a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from Vanderbilt. I practiced engineering for 10 years before going to law school. I have a law degree from the University of Wisconsin. I've been practicing law for about 21 years, the last 15 of which have been in Georgia. I've practiced about everything you can name with very few exceptions. I've done misdemeanors, I've done felonies, I've done civil rights cases, I've done divorces, I've done major business litigation, I've done litigation at the federal level, the state level, the county level, and a municipal court. I've had cases at the Georgia Court of Appeals, the Supreme Court of Georgia. I filed briefs in the Supreme Court of the United States. I've been practicing quite a while and have quite a bit of breadth of experience. I'm running because I've got three main things I'd like to accomplish. One is I want to make sure that we refrain from judicial activism. Judges should only be doing things that they're authorized to do, finding cases as a result of their study of the law and the facts that apply in the case, and not the way they'd like the outcome to be. Secondly, I'd like to improve the Roswell Municipal Court process, streamline it, make it more efficient, minimize the amount of time people have to spend when they come to court, and get them back to school, back to work, or back to whatever it is they'd rather be doing than spending time sitting in court. And lastly, I'd like to improve the warrants process in Georgia, or I'm sorry, in Roswell, so that when our police apply for and seek a warrant, they're filling out the applications correctly, so that the warrants, if issued, will be upheld on appeal if anyone tries to challenge them. Thank you very much, and I'd appreciate your vote.
Before I begin, I'd like to thank the Roswell Women's Club and all the citizens of Roswell who have come out tonight to learn more about your candidates. I'd also like to thank my wife and children. Without their support, I certainly would not be able to engage in this endeavor. I'm Judge Brian Hansford. I've been sitting as a judge for approximately 7 years, and I'm one of the primary judges overseeing the City of Roswell Municipal Court since the departure of the previous chief judge in August of 2013. I am the only candidate in this race with experience as a judge, and the only candidate currently serving in the position for which I'm running. I consider my service as a judge as the means by which I pay my civic rent. Public service has always been a part of my life. When I was in my early 20s, I proudly served our country as a paratrooper in the 18th Airborne Corps at Fort Bragg. After being licensed to practice law, I served as a state court prosecutor and then later assisted indigent clients who were too poor to be able to afford lawyers on their own. I've also handled civil and family law cases throughout my career. Since I began presiding in Roswell in August, or more frequently in August, the court staff and I have implemented many changes which have increased the overall effectiveness and efficiency of the court. We've made our community safer, and we've saved the taxpayers time and money. We now handle currently approximately 30% more cases than we used to in about half the time it used to take prior to my arrival. I'm very proud of the strides the court has made. I've not made those strides alone. The court staff certainly is an integral part of that process, and I look forward to continuing with the initiatives that I have started. Thank you for listening, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you to the Roswell Women's Club for having us out tonight, to Lynn and Hal, and to our timekeepers. And thank you to all of you who have come out. You should take pride in the fact that you're getting informed before you check someone's name on the ballot. And to the football fans who are missing the draft right now, an extra big thank you to you for coming out here tonight. I'm Melanie Elwanger. I live here in Roswell with my husband Jamie and my three wonderful but sometimes wild dogs. I grew up in a town far away, but a lot of you have probably heard of it. Hope, Arkansas is where I'm from. I grew up there on a farm. Yes, that's where Bill Clinton is from, and no, I do not know him. We have never met. I found Georgia through Brenau University in Gainesville, Georgia. I was awarded a scholarship there, and I fell in love with Georgia and knew that I would eventually make it my home one day. I returned to Arkansas, to the University of Arkansas, to complete my law degree. Every summer, I would come back to Georgia and intern at different law firms because I wanted to build my reputation here in the community. Once I graduated from law school, took my first job, my full-time paying job as a prosecuting attorney in Forsyth County, where I prosecuted misdemeanor and traffic cases. I was also a DUI court prosecutor. I then took a job with Head Thomas Webb and Willis in Sandy Springs, where I defended the exact same types of cases that I had prosecuted. Through both of these jobs, I've been able to gain knowledge and experience from both sides of the courtroom that I hope to apply to the bench. In both 2013 and 2014, I was named as a rising star by Super Lawyers magazine. That is voted on by other attorneys and judges in the community, and fewer than 5% of lawyers ever make that list. I look forward to continuing with my dedication, hard work, and desire to serve the community on the Roswell Municipal Court bench.
Thank you. Leslie Donahoe, please.
Thank you, ma'am. My name is Leslie Donahoe. I've been in Roswell for about 11 years. I grew up in Dahlonega in Georgia. I'm a Georgia native. Moved closer to Atlanta to go to law school. After law school, my husband and I decided that Roswell was the community that we wanted to settle and raise our family. I've got three children, Aaron, Hayden, and Delilah. My husband and I have been married for 14 years. I met him when I was in Dahlonega. He was stationed at Camp Frankney, Maryland. He was serving in the Army. I am involved in the community here in Roswell. I've been a member of Boy Scouts for about 15 years, and also volunteer in various other youth organizations. After Roswell, I chose a career in public service. That's what I've been doing the entire time that I've been an attorney. Right after law school, started working at the Paulding County District Attorney's Office. I worked there for 3 years. After that, I began working at the Cherokee County Solicitor's Office. As a prosecutor, the only types of cases that I've handled have been those that would be before the municipal court here. Traffic cases, ordinance violations, DUIs, misdemeanor, domestic violence, other misdemeanor offenses, and drug cases. That's where I focused my attention as an attorney. As a prosecutor, I am in a unique perspective to administer justice. I look at the facts and the circumstances of each case, and I represent all the citizens of the state, not just individuals. I will continue to do that if I'm elected as the Roswell Municipal Court judge, and I would like if you would vote for me on May 20th.
Thank you. We're going to start with the first question going to Brian Hansford and rotate accordingly. Would you want to change the Roswell Court to a part-time operation, and if so, why?
Well, I think the answer to that question must begin with a statement about how that process would occur. First of all, the decision about what this position would be must be made by the City Council. No judge would be able to make that decision unilaterally. The charter for the City of Roswell does not define the chief judge position as either full or part-time. The only document that defines it is the budget. And the budget defines it as a full-time position currently, and I think the pay rate is $95,000 per year. So, having said that, if the City Council came to me and asked me my opinion about the workload of the court, I certainly would give that opinion and would absolutely give complete deference to the City Council and their decision. I think that decision also is a financial decision, and the City Council would certainly be wise to look at the numbers associated with it. Just a little bit of information for the public. The position pays $95,000 a year plus benefits, which adds about 20% to that total amount of pay. And then, over the course of the last 6 years, we have spent about an additional $16,000 per year for substitute judges like myself.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Melanie, the same question, I'll repeat it. Would you want to change the Roswell Court to a part-time operation, and if so, why?
As I see the court now, no, I do not believe it should be changed to a part-time position. There was a study done years ago when Roswell's population was around 82,000 by the Center for State Courts that said Roswell should become a full-time position immediately. Now Roswell has closer to 93,000 residents. We have more police officers, more businesses, more ordinances in the city And I think that we would be taking a step back to cut the court back to a part-time status. Additionally, a part-time judge is going to be someone who comes in and out of court a couple of days a week and will not be connected and tied to the community if they were here every day.
Thank you. Leslie Donahue, do you want me to repeat the question?
No, ma'am. I do not believe that it would be appropriate for the position to be part-time. The reason for that is severalfold. For one, I have heard stories from attorneys just this week who waited hours to have their cases heard. I think that if anything, we need to add more days in court, add more so that the calendars can be smaller and the public and their attorneys don't have to wait as long. As far as the salary being reduced, I would be in favor of a comparable salary to any other position in the state or any other city with a similar population. If there are, like Ms. Elwanger was saying, if there was a, this was a part-time position, there would be no chief judge. There would be no one acting as the person responsible for the administration of the court. For example, managing the calendars and scheduling different types of hearings. They would come in, handle a calendar, and leave. For the past 9 months, there has been no one serving in that capacity. And for the past 9 months, wait times have gotten, have increased tremendously from my understanding. If anything, I think that we could possibly add more judges. I know Marietta, which has a population of about 60,000, currently has 9 part-time municipal court judges.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And Mr. Monroe.
Well, this is exactly the kind of thing I was talking about in my opening remarks when I was talking about avoiding judicial activism and doing things that judges shouldn't do. It's not the province of the judge to decide whether it's a part-time or full-time job, what the salary ought to be, or anything like that. That's the sole province of the mayor and council. I would defer to the mayor and council to make the position whatever they thought in their discretion it ought to be.
Thank you. Yeah. The next question will start with Melanie.
First, I'd like to thank the Roswell Women's Club for hosting this event and the city of Roswell for allowing us to use this facility. And also thank the candidates who are here to participate. And you all look a little bit nervous, so I want you to understand I've gone through all of these questions and none of them begin with the phrase, "Is it true you were once caught?" This next question, we will begin with Melanie O'Reilly. Some candidates have said they will work to keep the community safe. How in particular can a judge do anything within the bounds of his or her authority to keep a community safe?
Thank you. It's more the police officer's job to keep our community safe in terms of deterring crime and arresting people who they believe have committed crimes. But a judge can help in that regard. A judge can help by being involved in the community, talking to groups, going to schools, talking to children, letting them know the consequences of their actions before they commit, before they do something that they think is petty, but that can ruin their lives. So that's how I think a judge, one way a judge can, I guess, deter crime or keep the community safe is just to let people know and make people be aware of the law. Ignorance of the law is no excuse when you come in front of a judge. So make sure people understand the law so they don't break it and end up in court.
Mr. Donahue, would you like me to repeat the question?
Yes, please.
Okay. Some candidates have said they will work to keep the community safe. How in particular can a judge do anything within the bounds of his or her authority to keep the community safe?
Thank you. The types of crimes that are here in the Roswell court are predominantly traffic offenses and ordinance violations. Preventing those types of crimes would add to the safety of the community and the comfort of its residents. In this particular situation, when a judge makes an appropriate sentence for a violator, that would deter future violations. And that, of course, would then add to the safety of the community. An appropriate sentence would be one that's fashioned around the facts and the circumstances of the case, that particular person who's accused, their criminal history, and the wishes of any victims that are involved. As Roswell's judge, I would do that, and of course, always work within the ethical rules and the moral rules as judges. Thank you.
Governor, would you like me to repeat the question?
No, thank you. Well, I hope I'm not sounding like a broken record, but again, I don't think that's the province of the judiciary to make the community safe. Sometimes the correct outcome in a case will have the potential effect of making the community less safe. But the judge is supposed to decide the case based on the law and the facts of the case, not in what he or her thinks the outcome ought to be. It's an adversarial system. There's a solicitor in our court who does a very good job. Her job is to represent the community. That's not the judge's role. There's also a defendant who may or may not have an attorney, and their role is to represent the interests of the individual being charged with something. The judge just weighs the facts and decides the case. In some cases, that might have the effect of making the community safer, and sometimes it may have the opposite effect, but that's not something the judge should be taking into account.
Brian Hatch.
Mr. Coleman,
your question?
No, sir, I'm good. Mr. Coleman, when I came in August of 2013, one of the things that was not being done to keep the community safe is we were not seeing defendants who were incarcerated over the weekends. Georgia law requires that an incarcerated defendant be seen either within 48 or 72 hours of his or her arrest, whether that be with or without a warrant. Problem is that if they're not seen, it is mandatory that the police agency let them go back into our community. I realized shortly after coming here that we weren't doing that. I talked to the city officials, the assistant, our deputy city manager, and volunteered to start going on the weekends to conduct those weekend first appearance hearings so that we could ensure, number one, that people were not being let go back on our streets without being seen by a judge, and number two, that these folks who were incarcerated got an opportunity to see a judge and hear their rights and understand the process that they were about to go through. I would also like to point out that with the recent expansion of the City of Roswell Ordinance Code, in the last 2 weeks that I've been sitting, I have seen a gang leader in front of me on a City of Roswell ordinance violation, the leader of the 400 gang, and we have dealt with a man who was wielding a knife on school property in Chanting. So those are the kinds of cases we're seeing here in Roswell. It's not just traffic and DUIs.
The next question will start with Leslie Donahoe. Do you think the Roswell Municipal Judge's position is a full-time job? And would you plan to continue a private practice or other job as well if it was not?
My understanding is that the position is a full-time position and has been for at least 10 years. I work as a prosecutor. One of the rules of a prosecutor is that I cannot practice law outside of my position. Similarly, the ethical rules for a full-time judge is that he or she cannot practice law outside of his or her position. So for that reason, no, I would absolutely not, even if I were permitted to do so. I would focus all my attention on the citizens of Roswell.
Thank you. John Monroe.
Well, I don't have an opinion on whether it's a full-time or part-time job. Again, that's up to the city council to decide what it is. If it were a part-time job, would I continue a practice? I guess it would depend on what kind of part-time job it is. I can tell you I work a lot, and if it were a situation where you only had to go to court twice a week and had afternoons off and didn't have to work the other 5 days of the week, I'd be doing something because I'm not one to go home and sit around and do nothing. Maybe it'd be volunteer work, maybe it'd be maintaining a practice, I don't know. But I wouldn't be sitting around twiddling my thumbs, I can tell you that.
Brian.
Thank you. Well, I would certainly echo once again that that is a decision that lies within the province of the City Council. It is currently defined as a full-time position, but I guess what I would point out as the only person who's sitting here right now, we are, for the first 5 months of this year, we have seen 30% more cases than we saw in the first 5 months of 2013. And we're doing that in about half the time. We're meeting 2 days a week, Monday and Wednesday, and we're seeing 30% more cases. In fact, for the month of April, that month in particular is up by 60%. And once again, we're doing that in 2 days a week. So would I give my suggestions to City Council if they asked? Of course I would. If they said, Judge Hansford, this needs to remain a full-time position, then I'm prepared to serve in that capacity.
Thank you. As I understand it now, the municipal court judge is a full-time position, so no, there would be no time to have another job, and I would have no intention of splitting my time between the bench and another job. I know from experience that it's hard to give 100% to two different endeavors that you have going on. If it was made up a part-time position, I would probably have to do something as well. I don't like to sit around either, and I certainly can't afford to only have a part-time job, and nor would I want to.
Thank you.
This next question we will begin with John Monroe. What is the most challenging part of being a municipal court judge?
Well, there are probably multiple challenges to it that have more or less equal weight. One challenge is maintaining the docket and keeping it current. It's like a lot of first-level trial courts. There's a large docket. A lot of cases get heard and have to be disposed of, so that's certainly a challenge, making sure that cases don't get too old and that people in the city both have their case decided quickly and efficiently. Another challenge, which is probably true of any judicial position, is balancing the interests of all the litigants and making sure that they all have their fair shake in court, they all have their say, and then the case is decided appropriately under the laws and the Constitution that apply.
Thank you.
Right. Hal, I think the most difficult challenge that I see as a judge is serving in the community where I live. You see people that are your neighbors, you see people that you know, you see people that you know from Rotary. They have tickets, they have offenses, their children have offenses, and it's challenging to sit and be a neutral party and administer justice as you're supposed to. I've always done it. Is it always easy? No, it's not. I've seen lots of people that I know come in front of that bench. I've seen lots of sad stories, but my job as a judge is to uphold the law, and I do it in every single case that I see. A second thing that I find to be challenging now with the expansion of the ordinance code is we are basically seeing many more cases that typically would have been sent to Fulton County as misdemeanor cases. And these cases present complex issues. A case in point is one I mentioned a moment ago, a man who wandered onto school property here at Roswell Swift School, wielding a knife, chanting, dressed in black camouflage. Now, this gentleman had psychiatric problems. As a municipal court, we don't have access to the same things that state courts have access to, so you have to be pretty creative in how you deal with a case like that. And I would just state for the record that we have been very successful in dealing with those folks with the assistance of our prosecutor and court staff.
Thank you.
Thank you. I agree with Mr. Hansford that one of the problems, especially in a local court, is you're not going to make everyone happy, and that is unfortunate, but you have your prosecuting attorney, you have private citizens, you have defense attorneys, and everybody wants something from you as the judge. And what my response to that is I just have to remain fair and impartial and treat every single person who walks through these doors exactly the same. I believe that my experiences on both sides of the courtroom, I was telling someone earlier, I've played this game from both sides, and now I'm ready to referee. I want to put my skills, knowledge, and experience to practice to make sure that everyone feels like they had a fair shake and that their concerns and that their case was listened to and decided fairly. I think another issue is keeping cases in Roswell. I know from experience, I've seen in the municipal court, attorneys or private citizens representing themselves binding cases over to Fulton County. If a case is eligible to be heard in the municipal court, there is no reason for it not to be handled here. It takes more burden off of the Fulton County court system, which is already overworked and overburdened. If I am there as a fair and impartial judge, I believe that the citizens and private attorneys will have faith in me and keep those cases here in Roswell.
Thank you. And Lisa Dunham.
Thank you, sir. I believe that the biggest challenge would be, as Mr. Monroe said, to balance the effects of the accused versus that of the public. I, as a prosecutor, have heard many, many sad stories, but a prosecutor is in a unique perspective to administer justice. We've always heard that the judge is the gatekeeper. Well, the judge may be the gatekeeper of the evidence, but the prosecutor is really the gatekeeper of whether a case is in a courtroom to begin with. If in reviewing a case, I see that a defendant's rights have been violated, I have no problems dismissing the case outright without going forward, even past the warrant stage. Depending on the particular defendant, I have recommended many diversion programs and that type of thing. I have provided justice to the accused and the community. I have provided that balance as my role as a prosecutor for the past 8 years. And I believe that for that reason, I can and will do a very good job as the judge in Roswell doing that exact same thing. A judge has to make a judgment call, and I think that my judgment is fair and unbiased.
And this round starts with Mr. Hansford.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the relationship between the Roswell Municipal Court and the Fulton County Superior Court? And are there any challenges presented by that relationship? And you can certainly illuminate us on the interaction.
Do you mean the state court or the Superior Court?
It's written the Superior Court here, but
all right, I'll work it into my response. The only relationship that would exist between the Municipal Court and the Fulton County Superior Court is them receiving warrants and defendants who committed felony offenses in Roswell. Outside of that, we don't have anything to do with the Superior Court. Now, the State Court of Fulton County, we share concurrent jurisdiction with over several different types of offenses. And as I mentioned to you, with the recent expansion of the ordinance code that the City Council passed early this year, what we now see is our officers utilizing those ordinances to arrest people rather than arresting them on state charges. So a lot of cases that used to leave here and go to Fulton County are now staying here under those ordinance code violations. So the relationship that exists, I don't know if the question is the tenor of it or if it is how it works, but essentially, if we don't have jurisdiction over the offense as designated by statute, then that case must, as a matter of law, be bound over to the State Court of Fulton County. If we do have jurisdiction over it, then the defendant has the right, if he or she chooses, to bind that case over to the State Court of Fulton County. What I see when I sit is very few cases being bound over. Out of a typical calendar of, say, 100 defendants, which is kind of the magic number for us in a typical court session, I now see anywhere from 3 to 5 defendants binding their cases over, and those are not garden variety traffic offenses. Those are typically multiple DUI offense defendants, people with license problems or people with immigration problems that just want to kick the can down the road. The law gives them the right to kick that can down the road if they choose. So that's the relationship. It's a good working relationship. I know our solicitor and Fulton County Solicitor General share a close relationship and work together on many things, but that's how we work with them.
Thank you. Ms. Lyman, can you give us some idea of your impression of the interrelationship between the Roswell Municipal Court and the Fulton County Superior Court and Fulton County.
Yes, ma'am, I think I can. I've practiced in all of those courts, and maybe it would be better for me to start with just a little bit of background and information, because I've run into a lot of people in Roswell who didn't exactly know what happens in the Roswell Municipal Court. What do you hear there? What kind of cases come in? And it's traffic tickets, some misdemeanors, a lot of misdemeanors, and of course city ordinance violations. And like Mr. Hansford said, on some of those cases, the misdemeanors and traffic offenses, you are entitled to a trial by a jury, which you cannot get here in the Roswell Municipal Court. In the Roswell Municipal Court, your fact finder is the judge who presides on the bench. They decide guilt and innocence. They decide the sentence that will be handed down from the court. In Fulton County, that is where people get their jury trials. And that can be, the solicitor here can bind those cases over to Fulton County, or the defendant themselves can bind those cases over. The state court of Fulton County and the Superior Court, which hears felony cases, are fed into by many cities. We have Roswell here, Johns Creek, Milton, Alpharetta, Atlanta. So all of the cases that are being bound over are going into this Fulton County court system, and like I said, they're being overworked. I can tell you from experience, on a state court charge, on a speeding ticket, if someone from Roswell binds their case over, they will not be called in for their arraignment or their first appearance hearing for a year and a half. It could be longer, which is again why I think it is so important to have someone on the bench that defendants, solicitor, police officers, and the prosecutor have faith in, so we can keep those cases here.
Thank you very much. Ms. Donahoe.
Thank you. The Superior Court has general jurisdiction over crimes in that county. The state court has jurisdiction over misdemeanor offenses because the Superior Court allows them to accept jurisdiction of those. If the Superior Court or the district attorney was interested in taking a misdemeanor case up to the Superior Court, they could do that. Similarly here, the state court has jurisdiction over misdemeanor offenses, as does the city court when those offenses are committed within the city limits. For example, Mr. Hansford example of someone who wandered onto school property with a knife, that could be charged as a felony case and go to the Superior Court. I have worked in city courts in Canton and Hiram and Dallas, and traffic courts in Cherokee County, Pauley County, and been assisted in binding cases over to the Superior Court and the state courts of those counties. And the relationship is that, as they have stated, when someone would like a jury trial, wants to exercise their right to a jury trial, or when the solicitor would like to exercise their right to a jury trial, that case is bound over, and that is the relationship. There are many concurrent jurisdictions going on in the state. I have handled cases in each of those levels, and I'm aware of the circumstances.
Thank you very much. Mr. Monroe, would you like to conclude? That is a tough question. We've heard a lot of illumination on this topic.
Sure. First of all, I'll throw in one comment before I get to the meat of it. I don't think judges have a dog in the race of whether cases are bound over or not. If they're eligible to be bound over and one of the parties wants to, it's not. I mean, the judge has to grant the motion. I don't think the judge ought to care if cases are bound over or not bound over, or whether cases are kept in Roswell and not kept in Roswell. That said, I'll mention one important aspect of the relationship between the Superior Court and the Municipal Court that hasn't been touched on, and that is everyone has a constitutional right to appeal a case if they're not happy with the outcome. And in Georgia, the method for appealing an adverse decision out of the Municipal Court is you go to the Superior Court. you go to the Superior Court and ask for an order for the municipal court to send its record of the case up to the Superior Court to be decided essentially over again. It's called a writ of certiorari. So if you don't like the outcome of your case in municipal court, the Superior Court has appellate jurisdiction over the municipal courts.
Thank you, Ms. Leibrod.
Next question, we will begin with Madam Galloway. Would you recuse yourself if one of your campaign donors appeared before you as a defendant? And if not, why not?
In front of me as a defendant. Is that, just make sure I understand the question.
Okay. Appeared before you, I guess that would mean they appeared before you appeared.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, first, I hope that that never happens. I don't ever hope to see anyone in court, whether or not they're my friend or someone who supported my campaign or my neighbor. I never want to see anyone in court. What a judge has to do when a situation comes in a town like Roswell, you're going to know somebody who comes in front of you. It's going to happen. It's bound to happen. There's no way to avoid it. And what a judge has to do when they are presented with that situation is examine the relationship and see if they're going to have any bias one way or the other going forward in the case. Something that is also done is if the person who comes in front of the court has an attorney, the person who is charged with the crime can waive any conflict that they may have with the judge and let the judge hear their case. But I think what it boils down to is just to examine the facts and the relationship you hold with the person in front of you in court.
Thank you. The judge has a responsibility to ensure that he or she can be unbiased. If anyone appeared before me and I didn't believe that I could be fair and impartial, I would have the duty to recuse myself. There will be many situations, I'm sure, where I have some acquaintance with the person or, as you stated, may have received a campaign donation from someone. What I would do if, as Ms. Elwanger said, I would look at the relationship closely, determine whether I could be unbiased. If I did believe that I could be unbiased, I would still certainly let the opposing both parties know, I know this person, just letting you know. And I would do that for the reason of full disclosure, to make sure everybody's aware and make sure everybody's aware of the relationship.
Thanks. Monroe, if none of your campaign donors appeared before you, would you recuse yourself?
Well, actually, that's already been decided somewhat by the Supreme Court of Georgia. The Supreme Court's ruled that recusal is not required in that fact pattern for when a campaign donor appears as one of the parties in the case. That said, it's not unusual that a campaign donor might also be a close friend or something, which is not really part of the question, but if that were the case as well, then that would make it more complicated. But there's also a rule of judicial ethics which says that a judge should not unnecessarily recuse himself and should take as many cases as he possibly can rather than just dumping it off on someone else. So that said, if it were just a matter of a campaign donor, I don't think it's a matter of course I would recuse myself. But as Leslie said, if I had some kind of relationship with one of the parties, I would disclose it and entertain motions from either party to recuse. And again, under the canons of judicial ethics, unless you want to voluntarily recuse yourself, what happens after that motion is made is someone else decides if you have to recuse yourself. It's not on you.
Thank you. Commissioner
Hanson. Well, Hal, it's an interesting question and a question that I recall has been explored in Fulton and DeKalb County with Superior Court judges. You know, raising money is an unfortunate byproduct of running for office. You can't buy signs without money. So I echo the sentiments of my colleagues in that the Supreme Court has decided this issue, and it is not required as a matter of law for a judge to recuse himself. However, here's what I have done when I've been sitting. Obviously, I know lots of folks in various civic organizations. My campaign manager is a lawyer who appears in the court. So what I do out of an abundance of caution is I place on the record that I know this person, here's how I know this person. This is the extent of the relationship. And in the case of a campaign donor, I would say simply, I know this person to be someone who donated to my campaign. Madam Solicitor, do you have any objection to me hearing this case? Mr. Defendant, do you have any objection to me hearing this case? Notwithstanding some other conflict, as Mr. Monroe said, I think you do have to peel back the layers of the onion to explore the extent of the friendship or relationship. But notwithstanding some other conflict, if both sides concurred on the record that I could hear the case, then I would not recuse myself.
Thank you very much.
Let me ask the audience now, do you feel that you're gaining some deeper knowledge of our candidates before you? Raise your hand if you say yes. Well, that's the point of the end. Thank you, Roswell Women's Club. And candidates, do you feel you're learning a little bit more about each other? Well, great. I have a hard question. I'll say it out loud first before we actually name who goes first.
Who is that first?
All right. And the question is, and really this was one that was heavily debated in city council meetings, do you support the continued election of Roswell's chief judge rather than switching to an appointed process to serve at the pleasure of the mayor and council? Let's start with Leslie. Donahoe. Thank you.
I, as a citizen, do support the continued election of the position. That's the way our city charter is written. That's how our city was set up. That's what needs to happen here. That's as a citizen. As a judge, it's not up to me. It would be up to the city council to decide whether to amend the charter or to add to it, change it in any way. Until that time happens, I believe that when the decision was made by the city council to continue making this an elected position, at least for the time being, they made the right decision.
And now, Mr. John Monroe, would you like to tackle that question too?
Sure, and I'm, for better or worse, I'm heavily on record on that topic. I've wrote letters to the mayor and council, and some of them were published in the local media, so I can't run away from that. My position was then and continues to be that it would be unconstitutional under Georgia's constitution for the judge to be appointed, because under the Georgia constitution, the powers that everyone learned about in civics class, the judicial power, the legislative power, and the executive power must remain separate and distinct. And in Roswell, as in many cities, the executive and the legislative powers are concentrated in one place, the mayor and council. That's perfectly okay, because that provision only applies to state powers and not municipal powers. The problem is that the municipal court judge in Roswell, as well as in probably most municipalities in Georgia, exercises both local and state power. The municipal court judge issues warrants for people accused of anything, including felonies, which obviously is a state issue. And the police are out there enforcing both local and state laws. So if the mayor and council appointed the judge, and they also appointed the chief of police, we would be combining the state legislative power and the state judicial power all into one location, and that would be unconstitutional.
Thank you very much, Mr. Monroe. Mr. Hansford.
Yes, ma'am.
Let's hear your opinion here.
Yes, and I don't have quite as much to say about it. The short answer is yes. I support it remaining an elected position. I concur with my colleagues that the decision whether or not to change it would be a decision that once again has to be debated and made by the city council. But I support the elected process. As I've told many people, there are two main things that I hear from people as I'm campaigning. Number one is, we want you to treat our children fairly. That is a huge concern in this community. Treat our children fairly. Don't mark them for life for the record. And number two is, don't you dare change that thing from appointed to elected, or from elected to appointed. And I say to all of them just what I've said to you, which is, I could never do that. I'm a judge, not a legislator. But I certainly support it remaining as is.
Thank you, Mr. Hansford. Mrs. Elweiner.
Thank you. Yes, I absolutely support it remaining an elected position. I don't think that's been a secret either. I've been here many a Monday night in this room since August, waiting to see what was going to happen and have voiced my opinion on that. as Ms. Donahoe said, that is what the Roswell Charter says, is that this position is elected. If city council chooses to change that one day, so be it. But now, that is the Roswell Charter. I believe that when city council took a vote on this issue, Councilmember Iglehart said he had never received so many phone calls on a single issue as he did about changing the position from appointed or elected to an appointed position. You all want to vote. You want to be able to do that, and I believe that you should have the right to do that. I think that if the judge becomes appointed, then it becomes an issue of the judge is serving at the pleasure of city council. So if I, as the judge, upset council member Price or DiPolito, I just see them here, so I'm pointing them out, they can get everyone together and decide that I'm no longer pleasing them, and then I'm out. But if the position is elected, I serve at the citizens of Roswell. That's whose pleasure I serve at, and that's who I please. If I don't, you can vote me out. You vote me in, and you have the right to vote me out, and that's why I believe it should remain an elected position.
I think this will be the final question due to our time schedule, and I was hoping it would be one of those squirmy kind of questions, but it's not. It's an easy question. And we'll begin with John Monroe. John, how does the job of a municipal court judge differ from some other types of judicial positions?
Well, the municipal court is a court of limited jurisdiction, so it can't take the cases that are defined by state law, by the city charter, and by ordinance. So that's one big difference compared to like the Superior Court, which is a court of general jurisdiction. The state court is a court of general jurisdiction as well. It has unlimited civil jurisdiction, and it's limited to misdemeanors for criminal jurisdiction. And then another important difference that's already been talked about somewhat is because it's a community-based court, you tend to be dealing with cases involving, you know, friends, neighbors, colleagues, people you know and see every day, and that brings a different tenor, I think, to the cases and how they might play out. There's also no juries in the municipal court, so everything's done by the judge. There's no option for a jury. It's the judge is going to be the fact finder, and the judge is going to be the law finder. So the judge is the ultimate authority. And as odd as it may sound, when it comes to cases in municipal court, typically the judge's decision is final. I talked earlier about appealing municipal court cases, and I've appealed them before, and I've appealed cases from state court and from Superior Court before too. And I can tell you, appealing successfully a municipal court judgment is way more difficult. The process makes it more difficult. It's just the cards are stacked against you. So the municipal court judge tends to be the last word on the case.
Thank you. Mr. Hansford, in your opinion, how does the job of a municipal court judge differ from other types of judicial positions?
I think the main difference I see sitting as a judge versus looking at some of my other colleagues who sit as judges at a higher level, state and superior court, is the effect that I have locally. And what I mean by that is this. As Mr. Monroe said, by and large, and certainly this doesn't cover all of our cases, but by and large, the people that we see in our court day to day are Roswell residents, they're Alpharetta residents, they're Milton residents, they're Sandy Springs residents. We get the occasional out-of-state person who is passing through and had an infraction. But I've heard it said that in government, your local legislators touch your life more than any congressman or senator at the national level ever will. And I find that to be true as a municipal court judge. Especially with these new ordinances. We have, as I've said a couple times now, people being brought in on cases that typically would have gone to Fulton County. And as a judge, if the case makes it in front of me, obviously the solicitor plays a part in that. The case has to get to me. But it gives you the ability to tailor justice, if you will. If we know that a young person, or any person for that matter, has a substance abuse issue, if that case had gone to Fulton County, it would be 12 to 18 to 24 months before that person got seen. And what typically happens in the case of an abuser, it happens again and again and again before they get any help. We have a unique opportunity here with these expanded ordinances and with our garden variety traffic offenses to deal in a more intimate way with people who come before the court and really affect our community and the citizens who live within it.
Thank you. Ms. Emery.
I see a couple of major differences between a municipal court judge and other judges, and one, like Mr. Monroe said, is there is no jury here, and so I feel that the responsibility of a municipal court judge, while the cases may not be at the level of some of the cases in Superior or State Court, you have more responsibility. Me as a judge, I can't pass that off to a jury and say, oh, we'll let the jury decide. I have to be, as a municipal court judge, more cautious, more careful, and apply the law fairly and make sure that I do that in those types of cases. Additionally, with the types of cases that come to the municipal court, most of them don't carry mandatory minimum sentences or certain things that have to be done. Some do, but a lot don't, and that opens up room for creative sentencing. And by what I mean by that is maybe not just giving someone a fine or putting them in jail for a day. Let's look at the crimes that have been committed, and let's see what I can do as a judge to prevent that from happening again. I think in the municipal courts we have a good way to rehabilitate people and keep them from coming back to the court. I can't tell you how many times while I've been campaigning that I have met people who said that Judge Hilliard, who served here for over 30 years, how he made a difference in their lives, or their children's lives, or their grandchildren's lives, because he believed in creative sentencing and keeping our kids out of trouble and keeping people from coming back to court.
Thank you. And it's not how does the job of the municipal court judge differ from some other types of judicial positions?
Again, the types of cases that are before the municipal court are predominantly traffic violations, DUIs, ordinance violations, and a couple of other types of misdemeanors that can be charged by citation. I think everybody in this room knows somebody who has had a speeding ticket, a DUI, maybe gotten one of those pretty little yellow notices on your door because you didn't cut your grass that weekend. These types of cases touch the people in the community a lot more regularly than some of the cases that would be in the Superior Court. For example, I don't know anybody who has ever committed the crime of murder, and probably many of you as well. But probably someone in your house has gotten a speeding ticket before. So for that reason, the city court is closer to the city. It's closer to the people. And that's one of the big differences between it and the Fulton County courts, where, as some of the other candidates have said, cases take 18 months, 2 years to even get on a calendar. Again, as they've stated, you can't have a jury trial here in the municipal court. But every criminal defendant has the right to a jury trial. They have the same rights. So they would have to go to another court to do that. But the judge is more connected to the community because of those reasons.
And the final question for you is, if you're elected judge and I ever get a speeding ticket, can you get me off the hook?
Outside interests. I am not politically entwined. I'm not I will represent the community and sit as a judge for the city, for the people of Roswell, as opposed to my own interests or any other outside interests. And I will ask that you vote for me on May 20th.
Thank you, Ms. Donahoe. Ms. Ellwanger, you have 1 minute.
Thank you. Being a judge has been my North Star for as long as I can remember. And I've tailored my career toward that goal. I couldn't be happier than to be running for election right now in Roswell. I've dedicated my career 100% to the types of cases that are in the Roswell Municipal Court. I know these cases, I know the law. I've done well in the years that I have been an attorney. I'm a good attorney, and I'll be an even better judge. I've practiced statewide in hundreds of courtrooms. I've been in front of hundreds of judges, and I've seen the good, the bad, and everything in between, and I can apply my knowledge and my experience to the court. I ask you to vote for me. I know y'all have seen my picture around town on my signs, my face. Vote for me, M.E. Melanie Ellwanger. Please vote for me on May 20th and help me serve Roswell on the municipal court bench.
Thank you very much. Mr. Hansford, you're 1 minute too.
Rather than tell you about me, I'd like to tell you about the court. I've already mentioned a case tonight about a man wielding a knife and wandering onto a school property. In the last 2 weeks, I've dealt with a double shooting, the defendants who were arrested and brought before me and then released by Fulton County, and I've had to deal with the aftermath. We've also dealt with a situation where a very prominent gang leader was recently arrested after the warrants were brought to me to sign. My point is this: I was able to effectively deal with these cases because of my experience as a judge. I call upon my 7 years of experience almost every time that I sit. My campaign slogan is "Experience Matters," and I know to some people that may sound silly or cliche, but when it's you or your family member or your child who has to appear in court, or when dangerous offenders like the one that I just referenced are being brought before me in the court, I think you'll agree that it is experience that matters most. I'm Ryan Hansford, and I ask for your vote.
And finally, Mr. Monroe.
Thank you. I definitely have the greater length and breadth of experience in the campaign. As I've mentioned in my opening remarks, I've worked in courts from the highest to the lowest in the land. And one thing that's kind of been given short shrift or glossed over is the municipal court does not hear only criminal cases. If you look in the city charter, the very first kind of case that is listed in the charter for what the municipal court has jurisdiction over is abatement of nuisances, which is a civil case. And I've tried many of them. In fact, I've tried an abatement case here in the Roswell Municipal Court. I think my experience speaks for itself, and I'd ask you to vote for me on May 20th. Thank you.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to point out to you that these people are not necessarily politicians. They had to go to college. They had to invest a tremendous amount of money to get a degree, to become attorneys, in order to actually run for this office of judge. So we all need to stand up and thank them for actually running for office. And particularly, we need to vote and ask our neighbors to vote on May 20th. So let's stand up and give them a round of applause. And now we're going to exchange the roles here. We're going to ask the judges, candidates, to come down from the dais. And we're going to have the candidates for the Fulton County Commission seats to take their seats in just a few minutes. We have about a 5 minute break if you'd like to take a comfort break.
Thank you.